Greetings, friends, and welcome to our online worshippers on this 12th Sunday after Pentecost. How good it is when God's children dwell in unity.
It is like precious oil on the head, running down the beard of Aaron.
Go into the roads and lanes, therefore, and compel the people to come in, so that my house may be filled.
Blessed are those who dwell in your house, O Lord, ever singing your praise.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, you gather from east and west people of every creed and color, as we meet today, remind us that we are all deserving of a place at your table, regardless of our status or background. Fill us with your love and compassion, that we would extend your hospitality to others and bring them into your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray the Collect for Purity together.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open,
all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We enter a time of penitence. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Let us call to mind and confess all the times we have failed to love. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw us to himself and cleanse us from all our sins, that we may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We pray the collect of the day together. God of the foreigner and the outcast, no one is excluded from your embrace. Inspire us so to love the world that all will live in the dignity and security of belonging in God's family through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now listen to the Word of God.
Listen to the good news proclaimed in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, beginning at verse 21. Glory to Christ our Saviour. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord.
Let us pray. Loving God, open our ears to your life-giving word and focus our minds on the message you intend for us to hear, so we may faithfully discern your way. Amen. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. Do you recognize these words? It's the prayer of humble access. Now the prayer of humble access is our prayer we pray just before we are invited to approach the Lord's table to receive Holy Communion. This prayer dates back to 1548, when Archbishop Cranmer first wrote the Book of Common Prayer, and of course we continue to use it now in our worship service. However, some people don't like praying these words from the prayer of humble access. The words, "We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table." Now, the reason they don't want to pray these words because they don't line up well with the type of modern theology that seeks only to affirm the inner goodness of humanity, and it leaves no room for the brokenness which is at the very heart of our fallen human condition. In fact, in some Anglican churches, they consider this prayer as optional. But like all good liturgy, this prayer does not come out of nowhere, but is based on Scripture. And one of the places this prayer draws its imagery from is found in the Gospel reading that we read this morning from Matthew. It's about a Canaanite woman who approached Jesus and asked for his help because her daughter was possessed by a demon. In this passage, Jesus and his disciples had departed into the territory of Tyre and Sidon, which is inhabited mainly by Gentiles. They have traveled there after a bitter debate with the Pharisees in Galilee about Jesus' disciples neglecting to wash their hands before they eat. Jesus also had to deal with the disciples' lack of understanding or perhaps their shock over his declaration that nothing that passed their lips was unclean. It was what was in their hearts that was more likely to be unclean. And I think that some of them just didn't get the message, so one can only speculate that some interesting discussions might have taken place on that long journey to the Phoenician territory. But our reading tells us that while there, Jesus is confronted by a Canaanite woman, which, if we remember from Hebrew scripture, makes her the ultimate outsider. She is a long way from being worthy to speak to a Jewish man, let alone a healer and a teacher. But as we know, when people are desperate, especially if there are concerns for their children, they will do anything to help their children. And this nameless woman or mother comes to Jesus begging him to heal a daughter. She comes to Jesus like all those people who drew such sympathy from Jesus in the last chapter, the ones who looked upon with compassion and said that they were like sheep without a shepherd. And not being Hebrew, she knows nothing of Jewish purity laws, nor has she any ties to them. Although there was no reason to think that Jesus would help her, but she comes to Jesus, as I say, as a mother, and she came to Jesus because Jesus was her last hope. But the passage reveals that Jesus answered her not a word. And puzzled by Jesus' silence, the disciple asked him to send her away because she was bothering them with her persistent begging. So for me, this showed that the disciples had no compassion for her or sensitivity to her needs. And so when Jesus finally spoke, his words were not the comforting response that we've come to expect. But instead, he answered and said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But the passage tells us that she came, not being put off by Jesus' words, she came and she worshipped him. She fell down in front of Jesus and pleaded again, "Lord, help me." But Jesus again answered and said, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." Once again, where we only see insult and rejection, the Canaanite woman is not put off once again, but she sees an opportunity, and in her words, we recognize the prayer of humble access. She says to Jesus, "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that falls from their master's table." Now, this humble response reveals that she understood that she approached our Lord in complete poverty. She came before Jesus with empty hands. She came as an unworthy, undeserving enemy of God and his people. And therefore, her argument was not based on her own merit, but only on God's mercy. It was her persistent, faithful, humble cry that gained her access to God and to the healing of her daughter. So just like this Canaanite woman, we too must come before God in poverty, holding out our empty hands before Him, staking our hope on the richness of His mercy and not on any claim that we think we have earned the right to make. You see, friends, the healing of the Canaanite woman's daughter and the prayer of humble access that flows directly from today's gospel and other passages of scripture, for me, it reveals the truth that when we approach Christ in humility, we gain access to God. When we stop trusting in our own righteousness, we then position ourselves to rely on His manifold and great mercies. When we acknowledge the fact that we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, we then depend entirely on the Lamb who is worthy, who feeds us not with crumbs, but with the bread of heaven. And so the prayer of humble access can be a great help in centering our hearts and our minds on what is truly important, that God will not withhold from us, sinners though we are, that of which we are most in need, His Son, Jesus Christ. And so we see, this prayer is not intended to be demeaning. Instead, it sums up our state of unworthiness due to our sinfulness. But it also reminds us that God will not leave us in such a state nor hold it against us. And so we are freely given the riches of salvation won for us through His Son Jesus and His resurrection. They are ours for the asking. And for God, God repeats His generosity to us through the gifts of bread and wine which we receive from His table. They are ours for taking, so that we may evermore dwell in Him and He in us. Amen.
Let us now affirm our faith in the words of the Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In this month of compassion, we pray for a hurting world which often seems overtaken by cynicism and apathy. As people of faith, help us to communicate your love and care to those around us. We pray for those who minister to the weak and vulnerable. We pray for those who shelter the homeless, for those who fight for the rights of the disenfranchised, for those who care for victims of abuse, and for those who counsel the traumatized. Uphold and strengthen them in the work they carry out. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, you did not turn the Syrophoenician woman away, but commended her for her faith and courage. Help us to seek your face in others, especially in those who feel excluded or alienated. May we be filled with your love and compassion, that we would be able to share your salvation and healing with those around us. We pray especially for our Anglican ministry, as well as our outreach portfolio and all those who seek to extend your love and mercy to those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the worldwide church, for all who are called to proclaim your gospel and to be ministers of your healing and salvation. We pray for Justin Welby, Archbishop of Canterbury, for Pope Francis, as well as for the Orthodox patriarchs. We pray for our own Archbishop Tabo and our diocesan Bishop Steve. In these trying times, strengthen and inspire the leaders of the church to be the shepherds you have called them to be. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those displaced by war, natural disaster, or economic pressures. We pray for the ongoing conflict in Sudan and Ukraine, for the many who have been displaced there, and for all affected by rising food prices. We pray for economic migrants and for the many thousands of refugees seeking better lives in Europe. We pray for those who perished in the Hawaiian wildfires, as well as the many who were displaced there. Help us all to be mindful of our excesses and, in whatever way we can, to work towards a more just and equitable world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, your lightest touch brought healing to the people you ministered to while on earth. May we too be instruments of your healing power, and your hand of healing, comfort, and protection be upon all within our parish, all who are close to our hearts, who are experiencing illness or suffering of any kind. Especially, we pray for those we bring to mind now. May they and their families know the comfort and consolation of your loving embrace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, death and hell could not hold you in the grave. Remind us that death is but a gateway to new life in you. Be with all who are mourning the loss of loved ones. We pray for the repose of the souls of those who we have known and lost along the way. Especially now, we pray for those we bring to mind in our hearts. May they continue to enjoy the warmth of your countenance and be at rest in your presence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, whose love knows no bounds, hear our prayers and answer them as is best for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray.
Amen.
We now say a prayer over the offering. Almighty Father, in ancient times you commanded that the poor and widowed be allowed to glean from the crops that which had not been harvested. Drive away from us all miserliness and acquisitiveness, and teach us that when we entrust ourselves and our possessions to you, there will always be an abundance. Bless these offerings now and use them for the building of your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And now the final blessing. Remember, beloved children of God, that a life lived without love is a life wasted. In the coming week, eagerly seek, therefore, opportunities to love, and you will be richly rewarded by our Heavenly Father. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love, now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.
St. Michael's has been blessed with amazing, amazing priests. I started as a parishioner at St. Michael's when there wasn't a regular priest. And shortly after that, Reverend Van Dyck came, and he had a nervousness around babies, that's for certain. Because when my daughter was to be baptized, he leant out to take the baby so that he could baptize her. She started to cry, and at which stage he gave her straight back to me and said, "I don't want her." Norman had this amazing knack of preaching in such a way that you thought he was speaking directly to you, your need, your problem, always. I was walking out of the church. I'd had to be here for some reason. I walked up, and there was a man weeding in the Garden of Remembrance. And he said to me, "Who are you?" I said, "I'm Jean Fraser." And he said, "What are you?" And I said, "A parishioner." And he said, "And?" And I said, "Well, I'm a lay minister." Wilfred said to me, "Tell me about St. Michael's." And I said, "It's got a lot of chiefs and very few Indians." And he laughed. He said, "That's fine, because I'm an Indian."
He was as spiritual as he was and structured as he was. He also had that, it felt this way anyway, that there was a bit of freedom as well. He was flexible. Yeah. He was actually my favorite. Mm-hmm. I was gutted when he passed away, sobbed.
The thing that makes me laugh when I think about Jimmy, Jimmy used to say to his three sons, "You are all so unpunctual, you'll be late for your own funeral." And we were out at the Garden of Remembrance to have the bishop inter the ashes. But we couldn't, because the ashes hadn't arrived. And his three sons were delighted. They said, "There you are, Dad is late for his own funeral."
There was just something about the way in which he preached and the way in which he spoke to us every Sunday that I kind of felt like, okay, he helped a lot with the service. So also having that one-on-one relationship with him, where seeing the kind of person that he is outside of him preaching, he still had this very loud, godly presence.
My father was very old, and he needed something. And I asked Godfrey if he would come and pray with my father. So he said, "Yes, I will." And he came along and said to him that he would pray with him for fullness of being, his fullness of being. And Godfrey then did a little service, and then pre-anointed him and left him. And a few days later, my father died. But at such peace. Quite wonderful when Robert died. And Moses said, "You don't have to profess your Christianity to be deep down a child of God." And he said, you know, at the time in the service, which was a huge comfort to me.
He came to the church with such a force. Having him as a change in the church was something that I absolutely enjoyed from the second that he got here.
I started going out and attending cell groups. I remember the first one was cult figures. And then, you know, people would talk about the church, and then you get the understanding and the dynamics of the church. The centering prayer. I also went to that one. More people there speaking about the church, what's happening about the church, and then I began to have a feel of what St. Michael is like.
What I like about the church is that it still has the traditional denomination practices. And over the years, seeing how it has changed and kind of kept up with what's going on in the world.
I like the retreats. I also went for retreats. I also liked the quiet times.
Gabriel as well, he also, as a youth leader, also tried to open up our eyes as the youth as well. And having him and also Dave as well as our teen church leaders, where the conversation that we had in classes was, yes, it was religion, but it was religion and life.
These priests have supported us right through whatever trials and tribulations have come along, and they do. And we all know about the curved ball that comes and sort of hits us when we least expect it. And I think, but for the priests at St. Michael's, it's very easy to crack, but they never let you crack. They kept you strong and they kept your faith.